So welcome to the Stri-Soom Seminar Series and today's talk, Alexander Wetmore and his Panama Expeditions, 1944 to 1966, by Stri Staff Scientist Dr. Stanley Heckadon Moreno, based on his upcoming book about the sixth secretary of the Smithsonian Institution and avid ornithologist, Dr. Alexander Wetmore. His book will be in Spanish and it's titled Alexander Wetmore y las Aves de Panama. We're also delighted to present today's moderator, Dr. Pamela Henson, historian with the Institutional History Division of the Smithsonian, who has been a keen supporter of this work. As we look forward to the year 2023 in celebrating the centennial of the research station on Barro Colorado Island, we are excited to take a look back at the enduring 100-year joint partnership between the Republic of Panama and the Smithsonian Institution to advance the study of tropical biology for the benefit of humanity. Thanks to all of you for joining us today and for being friends of STRI. We'd like to extend a special welcome to our funding partners and Canopy Circle members who support our research and make it possible. Aprovecho para extender una muy especial bienvenida a nuestros amigos y colegas de Panamá y Latinoamérica. Muchísimas gracias por acompañarnos esta mañana. Nos encanta tenerlos con nosotros en estos seminarios. Please note this webinar is being recorded. We will follow up with the link and share the recording with all of you. So before we turn it over to our speaker and moderator, I'd like to ask that you please share your questions at the end of the presentation. Please click the Q&A button at the bottom of your screen and click send. Dr. Henson will read your question out loud. And now I'd like to welcome Dr. Pamela Henson and Dr. Stanley Heckadon Moreno. Pam?
Thank you. Welcome to the STRI lecture on Alexander Wetmore and his Panama expeditions. So our speaker today is Dr. Stanley Heckadon Moreno, staff scientist at STRI. And Dr. Heckadon received his BA in anthropology from the Universidad de Los Andes, Bogota, and his MA and PhD in sociology from the University of Essex in the UK. Now, during the 1970s and 80s, he worked in community development and land tenure projects with peasant and indigenous communities in Panama and Central America. He's one of the environmental pioneers who developed the national parks and the comarcas, or Indian territories, of Panama. He became a research associate of STRI in 1983, and then more formally from 1996 to 2000, he led the Panama Canal Watershed Natural Resources Monitoring Project, STRI's most complex applied research project, and that was prior to the turnover of the canal by the US to Panama. Since 2000, he is responsible for the Galeta Marine Laboratory in Colón, and Dr. Heckadon has published many books and articles, including Naturalists on the Isthmus of Panama and a Creole from Bocas del Toro, The Story of Carlos Reed. I first got to know Dr. Heckadon in the mid-1990s when he joined the STRI staff and contacted Smithsonian Archives about the topic of his talk today, Smithsonian Secretary Alexander Wetmore and his 22 expeditions to Panama for his four-volume work, The Birds of Panama. I had worked on the Wetmore oral history interview and then had interviewed his field assistant, Watson Perrigo. I'd also worked on Perrigo's home movies of their trips to Panama. And two of my close colleagues, Bill Cox and Victoria Cooper, had processed a fabulous collection in the archives, the Alexander Wetmore Papers, which included 25 boxes of photograph albums from his Panama trips. And unlike most of our photograph collections, which are unlabeled, unorganized, everything, these were carefully organized into photo albums labeled with the date, the locations, and the names and details about the people and places he was documenting. Wetmore observed the people of Panama as carefully as he observed its birds. His favorite time of year was the month or two he spent in Panama in a small village renting a cottage and getting to know the local folks. Wetmore and Parigo were both country boys and they loved to get out of the city in suits and get to know the locals. Most researchers use the Wetmore papers for administrative and scientific studies. Not so Dr. Heckadon. He was interested in the people of Panama and immediately saw how much he could learn from Wetmore. And this fresh use of Wetmore's work was very exciting to me. I was really pleased with this. Even more exciting is how Dr. Heckadon has returned this precious documentation of Panama during those years to the people of Panama through a series of over 40 articles in Epocas magazine and locating Wetmore's most talented field assistants, the Hartman brothers, who were at the time still alive and farming. So we have so many photographs, accession cards, films, and interviews that document their important role. And now by digitizing everything, we were able to send copies of all of that to their families. It has been such a joy to watch Dr. Heckadon develop this project over the last quarter century, from watching him open Wetmore's wonderful photo albums for the first time and just be entranced by them. So I present to you Dr. Stanley Heckadon Moreno to talk about Alexander Wetmore's Panama expeditions, 1944 to 1966. Dr. Heckadon.
Thank you, Pam. Muchísimas gracias. And thanks to all of you. Thank you for joining us. This opportunity to talk to a great person that put Panama in the map and did so much to letting the world know about the extraordinary diversity of birds that this very small isthmus in between the two oceans that links both continents. I would like to start by thanking Pam, because when I first came to the Smithsonian way back 95, 96, I wanted to go to the archives, visit them to find out about Dr. Wetmore, another naturalist as they used to call him in those days. And she, you know, when you are a foreign son in a different land, you're always looking at the faces of people. How are you welcome? And Pam was the most welcoming person, which made my work at the archives, and I was astounded by the magnitude of the archives of the Smithsonian. And the Wetmore collection was just so extraordinary, and particularly the photos, which I like the most, because they are so much of not only Panama, what the country looked like, so different from now, the people, the villages, the houses, the trails, the rivers, and everywhere dug out canoes, as there were hardly any roads, and the rivers where the roads at. As you can see from this map, it's a narrow country between the very wet Caribbean, some areas they say range 13 months out of the year, and then the Pacific side, which is dry forest. They're quite different, and the Wetmore photos carry that very much, this differences. He started in the eastern part on the border with Colombia, and the Pearl Islands and the border with Colombia, and then ended up 22 years later in the border with Costa Rica and Central America. When he started, really, he had no idea that he would do a quarter of his remaining life would be spent in the isthmus. As Pam said, I'm by training an anthropologist and a rural sociologist, and so you wonder, what is somebody who's not a biologist or a zoologist writing about naturalists? And it was by serendipity. A lot of things in life like that. In 1995, the Smithsonian was having its 150th birthday, and there was Barro Colorado of the Smithsonian Tropical Research, and people asked me, Stanley, would you write something about this Smithsonian, how it got to Panama, when, who? Tell the story, because not many people know. So I decided, the editor of Epochas, and I like to thank Mario Lewis, and he said, write about Wetmore, for example. Write 4 articles. I never thought I would. That was way back in 1995. And to this day, I'm writing a monthly column. It's a lot of work. You have to do a lot of research and sit down and translate. This has happened with Wetmore. I had to translate an enormous amount of his correspondence into Spanish, maybe Panamanian Spanish, contemporary. And so I never thought I would do a book. When I had done maybe 40 of the expedition, 40 articles, some friends say, Stanley, well, you've written all these articles for Epochas, but why don't you do a book? So I allow myself to be convinced, and I started on the book. I thought I would not finish because I had a terrible accident, fell off the roof of my house. I don't know what I was doing. I'd climb out, checking out on my roof, getting it ready for the rainy season. And I fell from the second story, and I was in bad shape. And I didn't have the el ánimo, the spirit, to finish. But Francisco Herrera, who was a very good friend, retired from the University of Panama, said, Stanley, you gotta finish all of the Wetmore expeditions, and including the interviews you did to Dr. Wetmore's wife, and do the book. So I wanna thank Francisco Herrera as well as Mario Lewis to give me the opportunity to write to the general Panamanian public. I'd also like to thank one of the great institutions within STRI. It's the volunteer program. It's been my pleasure to work with volunteers. And this book on this articles on Dr. Wetmore and this book on Dr. Wetmore has been very helpful, very possible because of all these volunteers from the Catholic University, Santa Maria la Antigua, University of Panama, volunteers from McGill, you name it. And they've been very helpful. You know, I come from the telegraph age. So to me, computers were something, you know, I'm from the Underwood kind of generation. So I needed young students full of energy, sharp, that would help me with the, and this book in a way is possible to all these young spirits, technologically wise, like me. But to me, Wetmore was fascinating because besides being the ornithologist that he was, he must have been in a previous reincarnation, I guess, an anthropologist. He had an eye for the customs and the beliefs, for what the villages look like, what the towns were like, what the landscape, what the forests look like, the rivers in the Caribbean and on the Pacific side of the isthmus. So he came in 1944, and as you can see this map, he started in the Pearl Islands in the Gulf of Panama, as first discovered by Balboa, who had discovered the Pacific from the Darien, which was called Golden Castle. And the way, you know, life is full of these serendipities. As Pam mentioned, Dr. Wetmore was born in Kansas. He was a farm boy, ended up at University of Kansas. Very early on, he became an assistant to the museum at the university. And there came an opportunity because the U.S. Biological Survey was doing the survey of a land the U.S. had acquired, but had very little information. So they sent the U.S. Biological Survey was looking for young people to send to a place called Alaska. And off goes Wetmore, and he stole out there by the Biological Survey and his university professor. Well, you're gonna do, all you're gonna do is the marine mammals and the land mammals and the seabirds and the land birds, and you're gonna take notes. Are you going to measure the weather, and you're going to paint, you're going to do some drawings, and you got to correct the maps? Well, those were his terms of reference. He did very well. Upon returning from Alaska, again, serendipity, he's asked, would you like to go to Puerto Rico, which was another territory acquired by the US? Nothing was known about the birds. And his professor, on the basis of his record in Alaska and the US Geological Survey, the US Biological Survey, sorry, said, well, would you like to go to Puerto Rico and be under this very famous zoologist? It was Edward Alfonso Goldman. And Goldman was in Panama doing the biological survey of the canal zone. And by request of the president of Panama, because Panama just became independent from Colombia in 1903. So Goldman came as the zoologist, and he was to write the first book ever of the mammals of Panama. Whilst they were in Puerto Rico doing the biological survey of Puerto Rico, it is my feeling that Goldman would transmit his passion, his fascination for the isthmus, and particularly starting in Darien. And that would come later. So I would, the story starts with the Pearl Islands in the Gulf of Panama in 1944. He arrives in a military aircraft, and as you would see, as the story now I will share with you, it's that the U.S. had in Panama what's called the Air Force, Army Air Force, and it had bases, landing strips, and it had bases like Albert, and it helped a lot in the early expeditions of Dr. Wetmore, the support of the U.S. Army Air Force to get him into places. At the time of when Dr. Wetmore came, I will have to say that there were like three great contributions of the U.S. to Panama that have had a significant role, and Wetmore in different ways was linked to that. One, I think it's the creation of the Canal Authority, how to run a moderate operation. The other, it's the Gorgas Memorial Institute of Tropical Medicine, and Dr. Wetmore he was elected to the board of directors of the Gorgas Memorial Institute, which had to do with elimination of yellow fever, and later the endless struggle against the malaria in the countryside, in the rural communities, so many of them visited by Dr. Wetmore. And the third contribution of the US in this relationship with the Republic of Panama, I think it's the STRI, it's Smithsonian, the Smithsonian Institution, and particularly what's now known as the Smithsonian Tropical Research Institute, which was under Wetmore's directorship, lifted from being a very tiny station called the Barro Colorado Canal Zone Biological Area. When Wetmore would come, he would stay at the Tivoli Hotel, and this is Panama City, was maybe 125,000 people. This is the Lesseps Park, the man who started the French Canal in Panama. Panama was very small. You can see the canopy out there of the churches and the plazas. Unfortunately, if Wetmore were to come today, most of those beautiful little parks are gone. Now it's old buildings everywhere. Not necessarily a change for the better. But it was a very small but very friendly city with the parks. And in those gazebos, there would be bands playing on the weekends where they'd be the firemen. But this is Wetmore. He always rented the same third floor apartment where he could open the windows and enjoy the warm, the wind of the tropics, running away from that cold Washington and the snow and the colds. And he enjoyed the tropics. It was like being re-energized. And that comes out in his writings. It says, the cold I brought from the snows of Washington has vanished in the tropics. All right, Sonia, why don't we... After he was a very methodical man and a prolific letter writer, and he was a member of what was called the Board of Trustees of the Canal Zone Biological Area. But in 1946, there was a major overhaul of the American government. And Barro Colorado, the Canal Zone Biological Area, was on the verge of disappearing. And it was Dr. Wetmore's idea to put it under the roof of the Smithsonian. And it was that decision of Dr. Wetmore that saved what was an extraordinary little tree that was planted back in 1923. And there you see the first director, Dr. Zitek. He was an entomologist with the U.S. Department of Agriculture. So for 23 years, he ran Barro Colorado. And right next to him, to the right, is Chichi Vitola in charge of the personnel of the island, which were only like two, three peasant kids. And Chichi had to show these peasant kids from the Gatun Lake what was electricity, how you fix a motor, the mysteries of modern tech. And they're supervising there the tank. They drank rainwater. They would store it during the rainy season, and this is a big achievement. They now have a bigger tank to store. Kind of reminds me of Galeta. Well, we still have to use rainwater for necessities. And Dr. Wetmore would be on their right. And the photo is interesting because Dr. Zita is looking one way and Dr. Wetmore is looking the other way. And what happens was that Zita had been the jefe, the boss at BCI for 23 years. He didn't want anybody to tell him anything. And suddenly here's the new secretary of the Smithsonian, Wetmore, coming to Panama. He's now the new boss. And Zita would say, well, who does Wetmore think he is? I mean, he doesn't know anything about BCI. But anyway, that was eventually Dr. Zitek retired, and it was the role of Dr. Wetmore to choose the idea of having a resident naturalist. And Dr. Martin Moynihan was selected by Dr. Wetmore and a group of people, a very select group, because Dr. Wetmore early on realized he had to have an advisory staff. And among them, a critical staff of advisors was a very very brilliant Panamanian lawyer, Dr. Eugene Eisman Brandon. And he will come later in my conversation with you. Okay, Sonia, why don't we... Wetmore started when he was in 44 in the Pearl Islands. On a clear day, he could look across the Gulf of Panama and he could see the highlands of the Darién, this beautiful carpet of greenery, unexplored, unknown. And he could recall Goldman's magnificent tales about the golden mines of Espiritu Santo de Cana and the very old history of the Darién, dating back to 1502, 1503, and how Balboa had come across and run into the Pacific Ocean. And he made contacts. He took a U.S. Navy crash boat and went to the Jaque near the border with Colombia, which was the U.S. Army Air Force had a landing strip. And it was the furthermost eastern landing strip for the defense of the canal near the border with South America. And in this expedition, this trip to Darién, to Jaque in 44, he met the authorities. He spoke Spanish very well. He had been to South America, to Bolivia, he'd been to Uruguay, he'd been to Paraguay, he'd been to Argentina, and he picked up a lot of Spanish. And he had about his personality, he was a very gentle person, particularly with the humble people. And he would speak to them as friends. And they respected that, the sense that he treated them with respect. And this is the house. This is kind of like the typical house. Dr. Wetmore would come from the Smithsonian, from Washington, D.C., and he would rent something like this. This is the house of Choco chief called Conejo. And Conejo rented that house for to the Smithsonian expedition for $5 for a month. Can you imagine? Dr. Wetmore was in the Darien for about 2 months. And you look at the correspondence, he must have had a very good secretary in Washington, because she would send everything via the Army Air Force. It would come to Albrook. It was sent by plane in a DC-3 to Hake. And the correspondence says, Dr. Alexander Wetmore, secretary of the Smithsonian, Hake. Most Panamanians wouldn't even know where Hake is, but there was Dr. Wetmore. And from there, from that camp, he explored into the headwaters of the Imamado River, which rises in the Darien Highlands, which is connects with the Andes Highlands of Colombia and South America. Sonia. Whereas in the Darien, the rivers were the roads and the dugout canoes were the vehicles. And let me say that Dr. Wetmore always showed an enormous appreciation and wonderment about the respect that the indigenous people of Panama had for the forest. When he was with the Guaymi, when he was with the Kuna people, when he was with the Chocó, the Embera, he always noted with what respect, with what harmony they related to nature. And it comes through in his, he was very worried, whereas in Latin culture, it was more of a conquest of the forest. The indigenous communities of Panama were, and elsewhere in other parts of Latin America, this respect to nature, which is the mother of all things. His next job, again, serendipity, his plan was to go for a third time to the Darien, rent porters, go as far as he could go with dugout canoes in the Imamado, up to the highlands of the Darien, and then go over the divide into Colombia, into the valley of the Atrato. That was the plan. But then, rumors came of fascinating discoveries in a peninsula of Panama called Azuero, which now we know it's an island that rose out there next to the Galapagos Islands and then struck the isthmus and became a peninsula. And that they had found these creatures, as the saying went, prediluvian creatures, but also cultures. There have been some burials that I have found. And so they needed archaeologists and paleontologists. And Dr. Wetmore is asked by his very good friend, and this is a very key relationship. He early on became very good friends with the director of the Museum of Natural History of Panama, Dr. Alejandro Mendez Pereira, who is the brother of the founder of the University of Panama, Dr. Octavio Mendez Pereira. And Dr. Alejandro Mendez realized, appreciated how important the work of Wetmore was, and always would be very helpful. In Panama, it was critical to have the connections. And Dr. Mendez had something which was very important to Wetmore. He had connections everywhere. He had compadres, he had friends, he had mayors, he had the chiefs of police, he had landowners, cattlemen, and he would write letters of presentation. This letter introduces you to my very good friend, Dr. Alexander Wetmore from the Smithsonian Institution in Washington, and any support you will be providing him would be most deeply appreciated. So there grew this very good, productive relationship between the Dr. Alejandro Mendez Pereira and Dr. Alejandro Wetmore. Let me say that Panamanians in the letters to Dr. Wetmore, they used to call him Alejo. Alejo is from Alejandro. Some would call him Don Alejandro, but his friends would call him Alejo. Like eventually even his wife would call him Alejo, my dear Alejo. And so this relationship between the two Alejos, the two Alexander, was very productive for both countries. So when he goes, when Dr. Wetmore goes to the completely different landscape, not these vast tall jungles of the Darien, but rather the dry forests of the Pacific and the Azuero Peninsula is different. The towns are different. This is the Plaza Chitre. Vamos, Sonia. And then the Smithsonian Archaeological Expedition, which was sent to, at the request of the Dr. Alejandro Mendez Pereira to excavate this culture. It was Dr. Matthew Sterling and his wife Marion and Dr. Gordon Wiley, and they stayed at Parita. And Dr. Wetmore took many photos everywhere he went, and he was astounded, for example, at the architecture of the Pacific side and how old some of these cities in Panama were. Cruz's Trail, the city of Panama, 1519. And he thought, wow, the pioneers came to the US, the founding fathers in 1621, and here is Panama City founded in, well, last year we had the 500th anniversary. And I thought I would present the book of Dr. Wetmore on the 500th anniversary of the foundation of the city of Panama, the first European settlement on the Pacific coast of the New World. But well, the book has come out in times of the pandemia and in times of this wonderful instrument called Zoom. That's the way things work. Typical of the churches at the spire, you see there are these aditaments, and they are mother of pearl shells, because Parita was one of several ports that during the colonial period and the Colombian period of Panama's history depended. There was a big activity in the rainy season of pearl diving, and the islands of the Pacific side of Panama produced some of the most beautiful pearls ever found in the New World. Vamos, Lina. And this is the excavations photograph taken by Richard Stewart, a photographer for National Geographic. It was published by the National Geographic, if you'd like to see that archaeological expedition, as well as the later, the paleontological expedition done to recover the bones of these ancient creatures that had inhabited the isthmus millions of years ago. And you can see there the dry forests of the Pacific side of the isthmus. And I had great joy at the archives of the Smithsonian finding the letters that Marion Stewart, who was helped his husband with the excavation, she was a very observing person. And she would write to Dr. Wetmore in Washington about the customs and beliefs. And well, when you come to Azuero, beef is very cheap. The fruits are enchanting and very cheap as well, but there is no refrigeration. So you can't find this and you can't find that, but you can't find that. And of course, describe for him carnival. And you gotta be prepared for carnival. You gotta be wet because there's a custom they call la mojadera. Vamos, Sonia. Not existing big rivers like in the Darien, an enormous forest. there were no roads at the time in Panama. There was no Pan American Highway. There was only one dirt road called Carretera Nacional that had been built in the 10 and the 20s and the 30s and linked Panama City with Chiriquí near the border with Costa Rica and Central America. And in Azuero, you couldn't go in a dugout canoe nowhere. You needed to find transportation. And by that time, there was this marvelous vehicle that come out of World War II, four-wheel drive, called the Jeep. And Dr. Wetmore fell in love with the Jeep. And from then on, everywhere he would go, he would drive in his Jeep. It was all a whole protocol because the only people, there were no car distributors. The only agency that had like a Jeep was the US Army Air Force. So Dr. Wetmore spoke to the chief of the United States Air Force in Washington and said he needed to get a Jeep because he was going to Azuero. And so the jefe of the US Air Force, he even wrote to General Marshall, and they wrote a letter to General Harmon in Albrook to loan that Jeep you see there. So to Dr. Wetmore, to the Smithsonian. And so Watson Perrigo goes out to Albrook to talk to the general. And at the beginning, he was a bit afraid because it was this very big general in charge of this whole Army Air Force here in the Latin, whose role was the defense of the canal. But the general was very pleasant and said, okay, Perrigo, how can I help you? Well, he says, I would like to borrow a Jeep. So that's the Jeep lent by the US Army Air Force to the Smithsonian. Without it, the advance of science would have been very different. I want you to look at the ox cart. There were no aqueducts at the time. And this is the way supplying the towns with water was like. There's this ox cart, and inside there are these wooden barrels, and they're filling it with river water, by which time the population had been growing and trash was going into the rivers. But the people prefer that water because they said it tasted better than aqueduct water. There were hardly any aqueducts at the time, but that's the way of supply. I would like also to notice that although it's February and March, the dry season, the rivers in this area of dry forests of the Pacific side had a lot of water. They had forests on gallery forests along the banks of the rivers. And it's surprising. Today, that river Parita almost dries out as we have cut the forests of the isthmus. More and more creeks and rivers dry out in the dry season. Vamos, Lina. Sonia, sorry. Well, what you see in there in this photo of Dr. Wetmore, it's a revolution in health. These were the first pumps that were built by the Secretary of Health of Panama. And women would line up, and children would line up to pump water from the wells. And in the times before iPhones and Facebook and all that, that's how you got the news. People line up here in the water pump of the towns with 5-gallon drums, and they would gossip. What were the news in such faraway places as Panama City? So the news might come 3 months late, but that's the way it was. And these pumps helped to lower gastrointestinal diseases, which affected children in particular, dramatically. It lowered the death rate. So you're witnessing there a revolution in public health. Vamos, Sonia. This is a photo of driving. That's what the roads in Panama were like. They were not paved. This is just in the dry season, there were a lot of dust. In the rainy season, there's a lot of mud. But what I want you to concentrate is, look, this is another revolution captured by the the camera, the Leica camera of Dr. Wetmore, and it's the transformation of the 300-year-old Spanish cattle ranching stock. The first milk breeds are coming in, Holstein cows, and there you can see this black and white and the combinations. And the fact that Nestle built a milk plant and would buy from the peasants the milk, go to their farms, collect it to make powder milk, was a revolution economically as well. For a lot of small peasants, landholders, who had 5 or 10 milking cows, the check from the Nestle factory that would come out every 15 days, that was their main source of income all over Panama, all over the Pacific. So there what you're witnessing is a major transformation in the agricultural history of Panama, started by breeds coming in and being blended with the old Spanish beef stocks brought from the Iberian Peninsula in the 1500s. And this is the road leading to an American radio station called Pedací, which monitor communications in the Gulf of Panama. All right, Sonia, let's show the next one. And here's our dear friend, Dr. Alejo Wetmore. He's after going out during the day with Perigo, in the afternoon he would sit, there's a jeep, and then he would sit preparing the specimens he'd gotten, and he was the big attraction. He was the biggest attraction in town, and kids would come all over and they would say, well, God, let's go and see the big tall gringo who studies birds. He shoots them, but it's not to eat them, it's to study them. And they also would bring specimens for him to see if he would buy them. And he always took the time. And that was one of his charms, one of his characteristics. He was always willing to explain to people what is it he did, why are birds important, why are forests important. In those days, very seldom a car would come to those places. And when a car would show up with somebody driving it, and he would go to a place like Parita and say, well, where is there to see in Parita? And the kids would say, ah, you gotta go see the tall gringo who studies birds. So he became kind of like the main attraction in the villages he would go to. All right. This is another photo in a place called, in a town called Pese. In the province of Herrera in the Azuero Peninsula. And I want you to see the revolution is coming. It's the Royal Crown Cola. It was the first big Royal Cola, bigger than the Coca-Cola. Yeah, I think it was like 7 ounces. And this, it's the architecture of rural Panama. You can see it there, the tiles, the adobe walls, the kids, as you can see, some of them or most don't have shoes. Store that says relax and enjoy, like Watson Perry was doing, probably had a plant of its own, electrical plant. In those days, there was hardly any electricity in the rural towns of Panama. That will come much later with the building of the first hydroelectrical projects. All right, so this is the Azuero. He liked the people of Azuero very much. He writes that Dr. Wetmore in his reports that men were cutting down the forest in the Azuero Peninsula so fast, erosion was becoming a serious problem. And in the future, we would have to deal with the problems of the water supply. Where would mankind in the rural areas of Latin America or the world would get high quality water if we kept destroying our forests? The US Army during World War II had built a trail from Colón west towards known as La Costa Abajo de Colón, which was discovered by the Admiral of the Ocean Sea, Christopher Columbus, in 1502. And Dr. Wetmore wanted to go really distant place because it was unknown, the Caribbean coast of Panama, scientifically. And he wrote to his friends who had organized expeditions way back, like Ludlow Griscom at Harvard, and Dr. Chapman at the Museum of Natural History, about where should he install himself, go to the Caribbean coast. He wanted to go to a very distant place called Rio Calovémora, where I worked way back in the 1970s. But he decided, in the Smithsonian, the board said, the jefes of the Smithsonian, they said, Wetmore, you can't go to Calovémora. I mean, like, it's like 1 month to get out there. So how are you going to communicate with you? You got to be closer in case of an emergency. You got to sign something. Can you imagine a secretary of the Smithsonian coming for 1 or 2 months, going to the most isolated place, including places in which the maps were hardly of any use whatsoever? So there's the Jeep there, and there are our salute. And that was the end of, say, civilization as far as it, cars would go. And he's coming into a different ecological system, the very wet forests of the Caribbean. And this area of Colón, the Costa Abajo, the lower coast of Colón, is mostly inhabited by Black people called costeños. The palm tree, the rice and coconut is like the food. They religiously, they are devout devotees of the Black Christ of Portobello. They are magnificent drummers, hardworking people, and they depend on bananas way before that, and the tapping of rubber and bananas. All right. Now, how you get from Salud to Rio Indio, this is the next step of the transportation, Sonia. And that's the crew that the Smithsonian had to contract to go down the beach of Costa Abajo de Colón. And the jefe of that, the chief of the expedition, so to speak, because Dr. Wetmore dealt with one person who was, somebody in Panama told him, if you go to the Costa Abajo de Colón, you gotta talk to Lala. He's the man, he will hire the rest. And so in there is Lala. He's always smoking, but I can't find him there in that photo. He always had a pipe. So those were the men who in those baskets, woven baskets from forest vines, would carry the Smithsonian cargo in their backs, about 50, 75 pounds per person. And then out of the blue, there's this guy, this costeño, coming in a little dugout canoe with a sail, and said he would cut the price on transport. He would do it, take all of the cargo, all the equipment for half the price of all these men you see there. So Wetmore and Perigo start talking, and finally Perigo convinces Dr. Wetmore that they should maybe only send half via the sailboat, which they did. And well, that sailboat sank at the entrance to the Rio Indio River. And they had to spend the first 3 days of the expedition having to dry up everything. And in his interviews that Pam did to Watson Perigo, that trip down the beaches, the white beaches surrounded by palms of the Costa Abajo de Colón, were magnificent. He never seen such beautiful beaches as those of the Costa Abajo de Colón. All right, Sonia. And this is the town of Rio Indio. Usually the costeños, the Black people, would live on the coast. And as you move inland, there would be the Coclesanos, the Cholo Coclesanos, the descendants of the old Guaymi people. And their way of doing the houses is different, and the foods are different. But this is a typical costeño And as you see, there are every household had a dugout canoe, a small one for fast trips, and a larger one for cargo so they could get their bananas out to sea where the boat coming from Colon, they would load it, and they would be sent to Colon for shipment to the U.S. And then Dr. Wetmore would go upstream that Rio Indio and spend a lot of time. This villages had no dispensary, no electricity, no aqueduct. There was no presence of the state in those days. Well, there are villages like that today. Vamos, Sonia. I love this picture of so many he took there. This is Maria Asista. I wonder where she is today. And Maria was helping. There she is in her own dugout canoe, dug specially for her. And she had been helping her mama in the river, Indio. And the tide was coming up. And she was with water above her knees. And suddenly a shark came in. There were lots of sharks in those days in those rivers of the Caribbean. And the shark dragged that girl by one leg, and people had to go jump and fight with the shark and bring her back to land. And she was badly mauled. Dr. Wetmore sent somebody on a horseback out to Salud, where there was a telegraph. And so they telegraphed the Army Air Force at Albrook to send a new machine called the helicopter. And that girl probably was one of the very first helicopter out of the Caribbean, very far out to the Gorgas, to be her life be saved. She lost her leg. And Watson Perigo built for her those, I don't know what they call it in English, in Spanish called muletas. You could see it inside the boat, so she could. Dr. Wetmore in his letters always said that Maria Asista, who came from a very poor family, I mean, really poor, and she had struggled with a debt and life issue like a shark. She almost lost her life, but always, always she was a happy girl. She was always smiling, always saying buenos dias, buenas tardes. Humble people with very good traits, cultural traits, gentleness. You always, irregardless, you always had to, as a show of respect, say good morning, buenos dias, buenas tardes, buenas noches. So that's Maria Asista. I wonder if she's still alive, maybe, or she did not, but I enjoyed very much Dr. Wertman's description of her, although she was very poor, always so gentle, always very happy, willing to help. Sonia. As they move up the river, they run into a different culture. This is what's called the Cholo Coclesano. This is a combination. They were descendants of the Guaymi people, the Nobe of today. There is the, today we have what's called the Nobe Comarca or reservation that covers a big chunk of three provinces of Panama. It's one of my pleasures during my 70s and 80s to help in the establishment of these territories. But as you can see, the housing is different. There's a church, quite different from the coastal communities. Vamos. as Wetmore and Perigo were out there in the jungles of the very wet jungles of the coast of Colon, on the slopes of the continental divide, they would come and they would have this very hungry. And these were the cooks. And I love the way Dr. Wetmore would recognize the support of very humble people who would do crucial jobs for an expedition. And Maria and Delia, these two girls from El Uracillo in the Caribbean side of Panama, would always be ready. The meal will be ready. They will wash the dishes and they were very tidy and clean. So he was always very grateful, and it was one of his traits. He would take pictures of those people who helped him in the countryside. and then take time when he got back from Panama after a month, 2 months, 3 months, and he had a pile of correspondence waiting for him at the Smithsonian, and he would take time to have that photograph developed and write a letter, a thank you note. And I thought that trait of this great man, not only was he a great scientist, a great naturalist, a friend of Panama, but also the way he treated with dignity, people, humble people, but without whose contribution, scientific expeditions like his would not have been possible. He had to have the goodwill of those who helped him. Vamos. And thanks to the notes he carried from his friends in Panama City, he met Diego Hernandez. He was a principal citizen. We call him he's a corregidor. Uracillo is a corregimiento. That's the smallest Panamanian administrative unit. I think it would be equivalent to the county or something like that in the US. I don't know, but we call it. But Diego Hernandez, again, was the person who out there in the middle of nowhere would be so friendly to Dr. Wetmore and his expedition. You gotta go here, you should go there because there's so many birds. And so the success or failure of scientific expeditions would hinge at the ground level of the support of people like that. More than not, he'd probably only been to the first grade or a second grade, but he was quite willing to help. Vamos, Sonia. From the very wet forests of the Caribbean, we go now to the central part of Panama. This is the province of Veraguas. Veraguas was discovered by the Admiral of the Ocean Sea. It was given to him as the Duchy of Veraguas. It's the only province of Panama that has 30 leagues of coastline on the Caribbean, clear across to the Pacific, and 30 leagues on the Pacific side. It's the largest province in Panama today, Veraguas, and the descendants of Christopher Columbus became known as the Dukes and the Duchess of Veraguas. They sold that right to the government, but to this day they keep the name. They keep the title, sorry, of Los Duques de Veraguas. And this is their headquarters, the town of Soná, a very good, typical Spanish city. Again, the church, the plaza, and on the top, on the spires, the mother of pearl shells. The pearl diving industry had died in the 1930s. It had gone during the colonial period, the Colombian period, in the early years of the Republic of Panama. And to thank God for a good season out at sea, they would donate to the church the pearl, the mother of pearls, which would be put in the spires. And at sunrise or sundown, the sun would strike the mother of pearl shells and it would give this glow, this beautiful glow. Vamos, Sonia. And this is the house, there you see the Jeep. And this is the house at the plaza where the Wetmores would stay, where Wetmore would stay with Watson Perigo, and they would hire a group of men from the area. And this is the only expedition, the 1953, in which Dr. Wetmore did not come in the dry season, but rather in the rainy season, and God knows it was a very, very rainy season. It was just poor 24 hours a day. And their letters, especially Watson Perigo letter, is like they were wet all the time. And any equipment you would put anywhere would pretty soon would be like green. Everything, the clothing, the guns, just about everything, the pipes, everything would be green, and taking care of the birds, preparing them was quite a challenge. Vamos a ver. This is a very anthropological photograph, and it's a procession of Santa Maria Auxiliadora by the people of Sonat. And the church is the epicenter of the identification of the people. That's where they're baptized when they're born. That's where they are confirmed. That's where they're married. When they die, that's where the masses are set. And the procession that marked the yearly religious calendar that was still prevalent in those days. If you could see that the street, the main street in Sonat was a dirt street, and that's a major town, but that was very typical of the time. Very few towns had paved streets, so there are dirt streets. And if you can see at the photo, this beautiful black and white photo, the way the women dress, and hardly any of them have shoes. Shoes were very expensive. Only wealthy people could afford a $5 shoe. Gives you an idea of the income level of the people, but the faith that would carry them. And of course, the great procession is for Semana Santa, the Holy Week. But it's very, Dr. Wetmore, wherever he would go, he would like take photos of the festivities, where the lay festivities like Carnival or the religious. And the church would also provide the baptizing of the children, would provide this network of godfathers. People would choose the godmother and the godfather and spread throughout Sonat. And everybody in Sonat would have his Christian name given at the church, but he also had a nickname. And when you do field work in Sonat, you better know the nickname of the person, because the Christian name, as they say, hardly anybody knows what it is. Bueno, Sonia, vamos. The next, I am having to cut lots of expeditions. I'm jumping, just I chose like two or three expeditions from the Darien to the Azuero Peninsula, to Sonat in Veraguas, and then to Coiba. Coiba is a beautiful island. It's the largest island in the Pacific coast of Central America. Again, it rose, as our paleogeologists would say, it rose out there as a underwater volcanic island near the Galapagos, and then it moved until finally struck the recently erosion isthmus of Panama. And since it was completely unknown scientifically, Wetmore wanted to go. In 54, he had everything ready, all the permits, to go to the penal colony of Coiba. But the president of Panama was murdered at the racetrack on New Year's, on the 2nd of January of 1955, and the country went into martial law. So the expedition to Coiba, which had taken so much effort to get it organized, had to be postponed. Dr. Wetmore and his new assistant, Armagedon Hartman, a peasant boy from the highlands of Chiriqui, had to go to the Chagres River, to the very famous entomological station of the Gorgas Memorial Lab at the Chagres River, Juan Mina. And there they're heading off in a US Army Air Force crash boat, very fast boat to rescue pilots. That's a World War II invention. And so it took no time to get from Panama to Coiba. Muy bien, vamos. And that's a view of the penal colony of Coiba, La Central. That's where the headquarters were, and the prisoners of Confianza. They are of Confianza, we like confidence. And it's called Bahía de las Tamas, this beautiful cove. Coiba had always, because of its strategic location and its beauty, had always been in the eyes of other interests. The French wanted to buy it so they could have coal storage there when they finished the Panama Canal. And they wanted to buy it from Colombia. during the Panamanian-Colombian period, when we were part of Colombia, there was a lot of leprosy, and the lepers were abysmally treated, and they were out in the trails. They couldn't come to towns, and there were thousands of lepers. And the government, the government of Colombia wanted to deal with that, and so they sent a scientific expedition all the way from Cartagena, and they came up the coast of Colombia and Panama, and then to the Pacific side, and they didn't quite find what they were looking for until they ran into Coiba, with its beautiful forests, very good soils, lots of water, beautiful creeks, these beaches, very healthy place. And they thought that was going to be the best place for a leprosarium. And of course, the people of the isthmus were very, very upset. And in particular, those of Veraguas and people like in Soná and Santiago, they wanted nothing to do with the leper colony in Coiba Island. So that was it. It kept being a major operational center for pearl diving until 1919, when President Porras acquires the island and the prisoners are to be sent there to be reformed. All right, vamos, Sonia. This is an interesting photo. These are the prisoners coming into Coiba. Every month or every 2 months, a batch of prisoners would come with their very few belongings. And they're coming in this bongo. They're landing there at the central, carrying their few possessions, and they wouldn't know how long they will be there. Most of them were very humble, poor people. They didn't have the connections, they didn't have lawyers, they didn't have politicians in high places who could speak for them. And so the legal system, they were like discarded by the legal system. Here they were, coming to Coiba, out of sight, out of mind. But then some of them were assigned to the Smithsonian expedition, and the success of that expedition in 1956, critical to their success, was the support of some of those convicts that gave the best of themselves. And we'll see some of them. Okay, Sonia. And there's the central, with most of the prisoners were, but near the central along the beaches, there were the camps, the prisoner work camps, and there were 11 camps at the time, and this is the camp, the work camp at Playa Blanca, and you could see the kind of thatches built by the prisoners themselves. They used their peasant skills, their indigenous skills, to take products from the forest and build their own shacks, or ranchos, as they're called in Spanish. And that's how they live, the prisoners at Coiba Island. It's now the island of Coiba, and it was, again, one of my pleasures to work, be one of those who helped to turn that penal colony into a national park. A beautiful, beautiful park, Coiba. Extraordinaire. Vamos. And this is the jefe on the left, Captain Zuza from the Policía Nacional, and Lieutenant Venezuela on the right. And they gave all their support to the expedition of the Smithsonian. They had letters from the President of Panama. They had letters from the Minister of Government and Justice, under whom was the Policía Nacional. And they provided the expedition with the best the island could offer, the penal colony. Vamos. And here are members of the Smithsonian expedition to Coiba Island, the unknown scientific island. On the left, it's my good old friend, Armagedón Hedón Harman from Chiriquí, peasant kid. He only went to third grade, but he was very intelligent, very sharp. And he was an assistant to Dr. Wetmore. And he was a great tracker, a jungle tracker. Didn't need a map or a compass to set it's called in Spanish a rumbo, a rumbiador. He could take you in and out of the jungle without a lot of GPSs and those things, on the instinct of people who are grown and raised in the jungle. In the center, Vicente Alvarez from the malaria control. And on the right, a very critical cook of the scientific expedition. He's a prisoner at Cueva, Christopher Richard. He was a West Indian who spoke English. So him and Dr. Wetmore could converse. And they're in front of the dispensary. That was the very best building in the prison. So the captain of the penal colony assigns the Smithsonian expedition. And as you can see from the smiles, it was like, oh, they were in a penal colony. They were quite at ease and very happy. It went well. It was a very good expedition. All right, vamos, Sonia. Now, of the different people that made possible the expedition, I like this. I wanted to share with you, this is Templado. He was assigned by the chief of the penal colony as the man. He operated the only outboard motor. He was an expert dugout canoe man. He knew the winds. He knew the currents. He knew the reefs, the dangers. He knew both the sea around the islands of Cueva and Cuevita, but he also knew the island, the trails, the history of the place. And he was always willing to help. He was the seaman, assistant cook, and guide, and land and sea, and always smiling. And in all the photos Wetmore took of him, he's always like that. Probably his only shorts, no shoes, and a hat, but always like a helper, a soldier of the sciences, willing to help. I was so interested about Templado, starting with his name. I began to look because nowhere I could find what was his Christian name, his first name, middle name, papa's name, mother's name. But everybody knew him as Templado. Templado in Spanish means a combination of hot and cold water, temper water. But that couldn't be it. I mean, lukewarm water wasn't the character of the man. And then I ran into an exception. Templado is like temper steel. Templado means somebody who is under very difficult circumstances. He's courageous. He attacks the problems. He solves them. Just like a smith who's working with steel, sinks it in water and tempers the steel. So that's Templado for you. And later on, I was so intrigued that I ran into, why was he there? He would tell Armagedon and Dr. Wetmore, that he spent more years living in Cueva as a prisoner than as a free man in the mainland. He hadn't been to school. He didn't have a job. He sold like $5 and he was given like 6 years in prison. And so the governor of the Coclé province sends this letter to the president of Panama to confirm the sentencing of Templado. And the president writes this self-righteous note that that's the way the law has to be applied with severity, because otherwise anarchy would ensue and people have to be shown the authority and respect of the law. And Templado had, on three occasions, had been detained for not having a job. He was unemployed. He's a poor man. There are no training schools. So on three occasions he's detained and charged with what's called vagrant. And since it's 3 years for one detention, so he is sentenced 9 additional years for not having a job. If that man would have had an opportunity, if he would have gone to a technical university, he would have been a great engineer. I thought, what a waste. And there were so many lives like that, so many stories that Cueva were like that. Vamos. And Dr. Wetmore, this man who started coming to Panama in 1944 for 1 year at the Pearl Islands and then went to the Darien. And then one expedition drew him to another region nobody knew much about. And he met the people and he began to write. And another detail of the man that says much of it, whenever he would publish something, He always took the time to send those who helped him. Dear so-so, thank you for helping me. And this is my report of Coiba Island. This is my report of Isla Escudo de Veraguas. This is my report of the Pearl Islands. And he had that nobility of character to thank, to see this Smithsonian. Maybe they couldn't read them, but it's a gesture. It hasn't been, the four volumes have not been translated to Espanol. So it's been my pleasure to write these 40 articles for the Spanish-speaking public, the lay people, on this book that will have 450 pages, 50 of which are Dr. Wetmore's photos, which are, I think, one of the greatest documents of the 20th century. Sonia? And this is what the cover of the book would look like in these times of pandemia, where we're all stuck and learning how to do Zoom, which I think is a great, I come from the teaching when we had four walls and 30 students, and now here we are. But that's a photo I chose because that's him. That's Dr. Wetmore, helped by this humble people from Rio Indio in the Costa Bajo de Colón. And as you can see from the smiles of the people, they were glad to help him. And he was very glad to be with them. And the outboard motor you see there was the first one ever to be in that river. It was used by the Admiral Byrd when he went to the North Pole, didn't use it. And then it was Watson Perigo's idea, saying, well, Dr. Wetmore, why don't we take that outboard motor, which is in the Smithsonian Museum, and take it to Rio Indio in the Darien, so we don't have to, in the Costa Bajo de Colón, so we don't have to paddle or use the poles to move up. And there you see the Admiral Byrd outboard, 5 horsepower outboard motor. Thank you. There you go. That's Dr. Alexander Wetmore and Watson Perigo. I think that photo was taken in the in a hunting club, La Jawa, or in El Valle. I can't remember well, but that's them working after a very hard morning. Here they are preparing their specimens. And that's, thank you for giving me the opportunity to share with you these vignettes. There were 22 expeditions, but I had to select. Most of them got stuck in my office, and due to the coronavirus, I couldn't access my main computer. So in the little laptop I have at home, I fortunately had those few expeditions that it's been my pleasure to share with you. And the people who made it possible, the places he went, and he would come today, would see that a lot of changes have occurred. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Heckadon. We have a couple of questions for you. And you can put them in the question and answer box down below, and we will sort of compile them together, and I'll ask the questions to Dr. Heckadon. So did you find any correspondence between Dr. Wetmore and Dr. David Fairchild, who helped found Summit Gardens in 1923?
Oh, Dr. Wetmore was, he was, in Spanish the word would be consuetudinario. He was a letter writer. And he wrote to a lot of people. So you run into all these correspondence with people in Argentina and Colombia and Mexico. But you know, Pam, I have to concentrate in my material on his expeditions in the field to places of Panama people knew very little about. But yes, of course, there are letters with Fairchild, with people at the New York Museum of Natural History, at Harvard. He would write whatever. It was interesting, Pam. Whatever there was, whatever there was a collection of birds from Panama. He would try to go to that place and visit it and look at the specimens. So when he spoke of the birds of Panama, he was not only speaking of his collection, but he had actually gone to London to look at the birds that were collected by somebody that sent from the United Kingdom. Or he would write to people at Berkeley who had been to Panama in the 30s or the 20s. And they would have this interesting correspondence. So the amount of, given the time that I had to write an article on a monthly basis, it was like, wow, what am I gonna do with the letters to Fairchild? I have to be another book sometime, other.
So our next questioner said, thanks for taking us on this virtual tour in Dr. Wetmore's historical adventures. You know what the current name is of the Amamado River or the nearest town to it?
Hake, it's the town. It's the nearest Panamanian town to the border with Colombia. Still there, Hake. It's got a little strip. It's got a school. It's got electricity now. And the Hake River is still the Hake. And the Imamado River, where he had his great exploration and stayed with his friend Conejo, the Indian chief. And the Imamado River is still there. A lot of the rivers in Panama have Indian names. They end in O or U or E.
Now, our next questioner thought you knew this one would be coming. Will there be an English translation of this fascinating story?
I don't know. I don't know if the coronavirus is going to happen tomorrow after the vaccine. Maybe a little plant from Darien will be the miracle drug. That would. But it takes time. It's very slow. I never thought I would write 40 articles on Dr. Wetmore, but it's been such a pleasure. Let's see how it's received by the Panamanian public, and I hope they like it.
Another questioner said, did you meet Dr. Wetmore?
No, I did not meet Dr. Wetmore, but I met people who met him, like Pam Henson. It was my pleasure to meet. I was told during a visit to Washington that his wife, Doña Beatriz, as she was called in Panama, Beatriz Tilen van der Vis de Wetmore from the Dutch Islands. Her papa was a governor of the Dutch Islands, Curaçao and Bonaire. And I had the opportunity to meet her. And when I first met her at the retirement home she lived, she said to me, well, when I said I would like to interview her about her expeditions to Panama, to places even most Panamanians haven't been to. And she says, what language would you like to interview me? She says, Espanol, Ingles, Papiamento, or Dutch. Of course, I have no idea of Dutch or Papiamento, but I say, well, it could be English or Spanish. So we did kind of bilingual.
Now, someone asked, can you tell us a little bit more about her role that she played in his career?
Oh, I would say that the only expedition she didn't go was to Coiba Island because women were not accepted in the penal colony. So she stayed in the mainland. But every expedition after 1953, she was there. And she ran the place. She ran the expedition. She was, in a way, she was the administrator of the expeditions. Took care of her mail. Make sure he responded to his mail, put him in a prioritary order. She was in charge of buying the whatever they were going to take for cooking, and she kept the camps tidy. I wish we had enough time to put you a picture of her in the upper Tuira River, out the middle of nowhere, and she's got this hut, which is the camp of the Smithsonian. She's a, you can see she's the jefe of the kitchen, and it's so tidy. Everything is in place. You knew that she could. She told me the story how they met, and I enjoy that very much. In a ship coming from Venezuela on the way to New York, and the captain asked her, she says, would you like to meet this young American ornithologist who's just coming out of the Orinoco River? And so the captain of the ship sat them together in his table, and they spoke all the way to New York, and that's how they met.
Now, they married many years later after his first wife passed away, right?
That's correct. His first wife had been of ill health, frail, and she had passed away. And Doña Beatriz was his second wife and companion to the rest of his life, and critical to his Panama expeditions.
Yeah, very much. So another question, did Wetmore leave notes as to where in Panama would require further studies to find new birds or areas of possible endemic birds?
Oh yes, all the time he was asking people about the map of Panama. First of all, in the 40s and the 50s, even the 60s up to the 70s, the maps of Panama had considerable terra incognitas. The maps were not very clear on it. Although the Americans have the Pan-American Geodetical system here in Albrook, but the maps were, there were areas of Panama in which the maps were a blank, not only physically, because you couldn't find the details of the mountains and the rivers and the villages, the mountains, but also scientifically. And Wetmore was always asking, well, who's been there? Well, nobody's been there. Is there anybody who knows? So he was always planning. I think if he would have lived 10 years more, he would organize 10 additional expeditions to places nobody had been before.
Now, our next question is, Dr. Wetmore's photos are such treasures. Have the photos and his letters from Panama been digitized by Smithsonian Archives? Is there somewhere we can find the photos online? I can start to answer that since I work in Smithsonian Archives. Yes, we have digitized all of the albums and we put them in our transcription center, and people transcribed, volunteers from across the globe transcribed all of the captions for us. So you've got really good information about what's going on in the photos. And they are. So if you go to transcription.si.edu, and we can append this to when we send the link out, or collections.si.edu, you can search for and find these albums, and they're just wonderful. But you could also go to the Wetmore Papers online and you'll see links there. So we will send those links along in case people want to look and find family members in old photos, find your grandparents there. And you can search through them. One of them was asking about Bocas del Toro, where United Fruit Company helped him out. And yes, there are photographs of Bocas del Toro in there. So he or she can probably search for those. And then somebody said, this is a funny question. How did Wetmore get the regents to agree to him taking so much time for research? It would be very difficult now, but back in the day, the secretaries of the Smithsonian maintained research careers. What more would you want to say about that, Stanley?
To me, it was fascinating that, I mean, he was in the middle of nowhere.
nowhere.
Okay. And somehow the mail would come to Panama by, you know, the U.S. Army, Air Force, or whatever. It would come to Panama. And then it was addressed, Dr. Alexander Wetmore, Jaque, Darien, Republic of Panama. And then Dr. Wetmore, somebody would come in a dugout canoe, said, Dr. Alejo, out there in Jaque, there's correspondence for you from Washington. So they'll send somebody in a dugout canoe, like poling all the way down to Jaque, collecting the mail, and up again. So it was like 2 days to fetch the mail. Can you imagine a secretary now doing that? It would be almost impossible.
Yeah. But, you know, also you see how he gets to know these local people and mentors them and develops their skills and gives them responsibilities. He did the same thing in Washington. So he had assistant secretaries and people who were in charge of his office, other things, who ran the place quite well and knew when they had to get in touch with him, which was rare, but they would if they had to. So I think that he had an ability to delegate work and authority that allowed him to get away for a little bit of time, you know, sometimes a lot of time. Now, somebody said, did any of the Wetmore or Perigo bird specimens collected here remain in Panama? Do you know?
The specimens that were donated to Panama were to Dr. Alejandro Mendez Pereira at the Museo de Historia Natural, but I don't know in what conditions they are. I would like to add that Dr. Wetmore was the mentor of a lot of Panamanians, and that was another of his roles. Eugene Eisman, whom he chose to be an advisor to the future of Barro Colorado. Well, what's going to be Barro Colorado, the old canal and biological area under the Smithsonian? Who would have thought it would be the Smithsonian Tropical Research today, a major operation in the tropics? And Eugene, who started late because he was a lawyer, he wrote to Dr. and they had this great relationship about Panama and about the birds of Central America. And the order has to be put in the names because each country has a different name for the birds. And Dr. Mendez, one of our first biologists, he was an assistant to Dr. Wetmore, and Dr. Wetmore was in the board of many institutions and who had grants and scholarships. And so he would help his Panamanian students to apply, and they would go to Washington or to universities and do their graduate work. And one of them, first name skips me, but I'm sure in the audience people would know, he's the first Panamanian to write books in Spanish about the birds of Panama and the mammals of Panama. And his name was also Mendez. He was assistant to Dr. Wetmore. And when he went to Washington, Dr. Wetmore let him have his office. I mean, like, whilst I'm in Panama, you can use my office. So again, the generosity of the soul of the person.
Now, someone had asked about Eisenman, so you've answered that one. Another question is, can you tell us anything more about the Panamanian Hartman brothers who supported Dr. Wetmore in the field? And you know a good bit of...
Well, I was intrigued by the Hartman brothers because they were so much part of, I couldn't show you those expeditions where they were in, like starting with Chimán, and there was Ratibor Hartman, and there was Armagedón, known as Hedón. And they were all the Hartman kids. There were like five of them. And I was trying to track them, to interview them. And finally, via a friend, Roberto Brenes, a school friend, he said that the Harman, two of them were still alive. So finally I contacted them and I went to their farm, to their coffee farm. Ratiboro was not feeling well, he was in bed, but Armagedon was still working in his coffee farm. He invited me over and I went for a couple of days. I ended up staying a week and it was a conversation from sunrise to sundown. And I did a run on, I did a run for Epocas on Armagedon, which everybody called Hedon. And Hedon was only went to a third grade because there were no schools, but he was a naturally intelligent kid. He learned very fast. And Dr. Wetmore had a extraordinary, I think very few people got to know the character of Dr. Wetmore as Hedon, because they were out in the field a month, 2 months, and that's very hard. And that's when they, that's when the character of the people. And Hedon only had the nicest words for the way Dr. Wetmore told him, taught him, this is how you should do, how with the birds, this. And Hedon was always very grateful. So to me, it was a pleasure to meet Hedon. And in the book, there are like 3 or 4 chapters about Hedon and Dr. Wetmore.
When you told me you had found him, I was so excited. We were able to send them pictures and films and transcripts and correspondence and accession cards. I guess they thought the Smithsonian wouldn't have remembered them, but for as long as I've studied Wetmore, I've known the Hartman brothers because they were so crucially important to his field work. They really were.
Yeah.
So with that, we're going to need to close our session, but thank you so much for all of these wonderful accounts of his time and the incredible support he received from the people of Panama his whole time down there. I think he really developed that relationship, which was so important to his work. So thank you.
Thank you both so much. And to honor Mrs. Wetmore, let's close by saying Mashadanki, which means thank you very much in Papiamento. thanks again for all those insightful questions to Pam for moderating, to Dr. Heckadon for taking us on this wonderful trip through rural mid-20th century Panama, as seen through the lenses of Alexander Wetmore and his team. There were still quite a few questions that we could not get to in the Q&A, but please send them in. We will be there waiting for them at strihelp@si.edu. And you can also learn more about how to support our work by visiting stri.si.edu/jumpstart. So we hope you can join us in future webinars, invite your friends so that science can reach even more people. And with that, pasa bon dia, have a good day, and we'll see you at the next webinar. Thanks.
Muchísimas gracias. Hasta luego.
Gracias.